marinate on that for a minute.
Kia ora, talofa, namaste, haere mai, welcome to the Nish Cash Variety Show. And if it sounds a little bit different today, that's because the bro, Dr. Scotty, unable to record on this particular day. Therefore, your boy Nicko the Wildcard, I'm just going to have to do my best on a solo mission here. I'll work my way through the standard variety show topics, and you might just get an episode that's half as long as usual, but it's better than nothing, and we figure we might as well at least try keep the feed updated, try hit them metrics. So, standard housekeeping yarns to begin with. Shout out to our Patreon whānau, the very generous, kind-hearted folks who support us with actual currency and help us continue to do what we do on our Kiwi sporting mission here at the Nish Cash. Love yous all, and anyone else listening who's not on the Patreon crew, feel free. Every little contribution helps, whether it's a dollar a month or more, whatever it takes. We're just trying to humbly do our best for the people, and the more support we get back our way, it's all beautiful. It's all very much appreciated. Also, got the old Substacker. Don't forget that. The email newsletter, get the links direct to you. All the valid stuff that we've been writing in the previous week or so, direct to the inbox, as well as a few bonus yarns. Generally, got some good Kiwi NRL notes there. Generally got a bit of Kiwi football. There's normally some fine cricketing stats to peruse, to feast upon there. We do what we can. Personally, pretty proud of the stuff we do in that Substack newsletter. So sign up amongst there. Don't forget the website, the bread and butter. Whack an ad while you're there. Share the articles. Read what you can, tell your mates about it, drop a line to us if you got some helpful feedback to suggest, all them kind of things. With that taken care of, I think that's everything. I think that's the standard housekeeping stuff. We don't have the back and forth today, so it's a little bit weird. But let's dip into the old mindfulness portal, where we seem to be in one of them stages of the year where there's a lot of holidays coming around. We had Easter, we had Anzac Day. I'm assuming Queen's birthday's coming up. Well, I guess not, because she's dead, but someone's got a birthday coming up. I'll tell you who had a birthday on the weekend, though. Most important of all of these holidays, it was Willie Nelson's 90th birthday. Uncle Willie, therefore, is the honorary supplier of our mindfulness for today. Willie Nelson once said, "There are no normal people, there is only you and I. There are no normal people, there is only you and I." So, you know, whatever you think everybody else is doing, no matter how weird or different you may seem, everyone's weird and different. We're all unique in our own ways. Shout out to Uncle Willie, who is the only person I've ever seen openly admit to having smoked weed at the White House. So there you go. Takes. First major first major category of the day, the takes. And my take is that, and I'm the only one who's got a take today because it's a solo mission, my take is that Stephen Adams' knee injury has robbed us of three incredibly valuable things. The first is a playoff run. Would have been beautiful. Memphis Grizzlies could have done something pretty handy if the wheels just hadn't fallen off around, I don't know, two-thirds of the way through the season. Adams' injury was a big part of that. Brandon Clark getting injured was a big part of that. Obviously, Ja Morant had a little bit of a breakdown, which didn't help things either. It was frustrating, and, you know, Dylan Brooks did his best heel turn at some point to try to take the heat off everything else, but then he failed to follow through on that by skipping out on his interviews and getting dominated by 38-year-old LeBron James. So, unfortunately, that didn't all work out the way it could have. Jaren Jackson Jr. did win Defensive Player of the Year, so that was cool. There was still plenty to be gained from this season, but didn't get the Stephen Adams playoff run that we really wanted, and it's unfortunate. They said it was going to be a 4 to 6 week injury. He's still out months later, expected to be out for months more during the off season as he works on his recovery. Which brings us to point number two of what we've been robbed of by Stephen Adams' knee injury, which is his exit interview. I mean, it's not just the exit interview either. It's like he I'll be trying to compile the old quotable Steve. What do I call it? The quotable Stephen Adams for the latest season, as I do after every season. And I'm guessing it's going to be a lot shorter than recent years because we've basically not had, we've basically not heard from him since January when he got injured. It's a frustrating one. But he also, he didn't even get to do an Ixon interview, which is always one of the most fun parts of the season, is when, you know, because it's the end of the year, it's the media is sort of letting their hair down a little bit, and you get interesting basketballing questions. You always do with Stephen Adams. You also get a few of the sneaky humorous ones there as well. He's always so good in that stage. But I didn't actually see him on the sideline, on the bench for the game six, the game that ended the series against the Lakers, away in the Lakers. I saw Jack Nicholson there. That was cool. Old mate Jack made his first appearance since the first game of last year, apparently. So 86-year-old super fan, still getting it done. No Stephen Adams, though. I'm not sure if I just didn't see him or if he just wasn't there, because he's been a pretty prominent figure on the bench through most of these things. So I guess maybe he just didn't travel with them for the last thing, or maybe, I don't know, the air travel is probably not great on the old knee when you're still working through things. Maybe he's, because they have now got some kind of plan with him, he maybe just stayed behind. I'm not really sure what was going on there. But we did get an exit interview from the general manager, Zach Kleiman. And if I whip over here somewhere, let me get the quotes that he said specifically about Stephen Adams' injury. Here we go. Memphis Grizzlies GM Zach Kleiman said, "We've been consulting with experts just to make sure. We're putting a pin in the plan before we put anything out. The plan is for Stephen, the plan for Stephen is a rehab plan in place that," that doesn't make much sense, but you know what people are like, spin things out of the top of the dome. Plan is that rehab plan is in place. Stephen's going to be diving into. The target is for Stephen is to return at the beginning of next season. That's the hope for everyone going into this off season. He also added later on upon a further question, to clarify on Stephen, the approach is non-surgical, not a procedure, just a dedicated rehab plan that we're putting in place, with the target being that Stephen will return at or around the beginning of next season. So no surgery, extended rehab plan, targeting a return at the start of next season, bringing us to number three. Sounds like we've been robbed also of the opportunity to see Stephen Adams in a Tall Blacks jersey at the World Cup, which, you know, 2 weeks ago, I don't think anyone would have thought was going to happen anyway. But then there were some rumors, there was some, you know, respectable chat coming out from a couple of the, a couple of sources who would know these things as well, that he was close, that Pedo Cameron, the head coach, the Stephen Adams whisperer, had got in his ear and was genuinely expecting that he, you know, this is a good chance Stephen Adams was going to go to the World Cup, that he was going to play for the Tall Blacks for the first time. That's obviously not going to happen in August if he's not, if he's on a plan that doesn't target a return to basketball until sometime in October. So unfortunately, didn't get a, just this pesky bloody knee injury that was just supposed to last for 4 to 6 weeks. He was meant to come back around, you know, a little bit after the All-Star break, maybe. Robbed us of a playoff run, robbed us of the rest of the regular season as well, which in turn, I should, might as well add a bonus thing. You know, he was on course to set some records. Some of those rebounding numbers were insane, and unfortunately didn't get to see the season through and do something incredible there. So we didn't get that, didn't get the exit interview from him. We're not going to get the Tall Blacks World Cup experience with Stephen Adams. Unfortunately, Tall Blacks drawn in a group that features USA, Greece, and Jordan. So I don't know, they probably could have really used him in some of those games as well. Unfortunately, that's not going to happen. Let's move on to some vitamin stats. Vitamin stats. This week, MacArthur Football Club in the A-League, in the 8 games this season, this past season, in which they had the highest possession numbers, highest percentage of possession for them in their games, the 8 in which they were the highest, it's quite hard to spit that out properly, but hopefully you got an idea of what I'm talking about. They lost 7 of those 8 games. In fact, the 4 highest of those splits, they didn't even score a single goal in those 4 games. Now, you may be thinking, I don't care about MacArthur Football Club. That's an Australian club. That's not interested to me. I'm not listening to a Kiwi sporting podcast to hear about them. Why are you talking about them? Well, I do have a good reason for that. It's because number 2 on that list, the game in which MacArthur had the second most possession in any game they played this season, happened on Saturday night against the Wellington Phoenix. MacArthur had 64% of the ball in that game, and they lost 1-0 as the Phoenix finally sorted out their spot in the A-League men's finals. Only needed a draw. As it happens, they would have actually made it anyway with a close loss because Western United were the only team within 3 points of them who actually won on the weekend. And, I mean, they just had they had the worst goal difference of any of those teams. So the Phoenix would have scraped through even if they had lost. Although, you know, Perth might have turned up a little bit more if they knew they still had a chance because the Phoenix were the first of those teams to play. So probably best not to read too much into that. And anyway, that's not the point. The point is that the Wellington Phoenix are traditionally a ball-dominant team under Ufuk Talai, and they went pretty drastically away from that plan against MacArthur. They really, you could see it from the start, like it was quite obvious. They really sought to attack early in their phases. There were, you know, quick outlet balls forward or over the top, running at defenders when they could turn the corner. Like, they were happy to risk losing the ball because they were happy also to let MacArthur mess around with it, knowing that they probably weren't going to be able to break down a structured backline. They did their scouting. They worked through the stats. They obviously figured out that number that I chucked out earlier. They obviously figured that out before anyone else. Came in with a game plan that was pretty much, you know, against type from Uffie's Knicks. But they were in whatever it takes mode. That those sort of quick transitional attack things did lead to the goal that they scored. It was, you know, Jan Saas turning around, attacking, dribbling straight at the defense, sliding ball through to David Ball. David Ball predictably unable to finish one-on-one, but the ball rebounded over to Oscar Zavada, who did score with his finish, his 15th goal of the season. Still never scored twice in the same game, which is nuts. But there you go. With Phoenix, whatever it takes mode, they changed the game plan. They did something different thanks to some class scouting. It allowed them to take advantage of a statistic for a much-needed clean sheet victory and a spot in the A-League men's finals. Look out for my preview later in the week, probably Wednesday, I'm thinking, previewing the Adelaide versus Phoenix finals game, which is taking place on Friday night at 9:45. Let's go deep into the Mangroves, where the under-20 Men's Football World Cup squad has finally been named. Had the draw, I think, a week and a half ago, where we found out that the Kiwi side would be playing against Argentina, who are the hosts of this tournament. They weren't supposed to be the hosts. Indonesia was supposed to be the host, but Indonesia had a few I don't know, there were some protests about the fact that Israel were going to partake, and then they decided they didn't want Israel, and then FIFA said, well, you can't have the tournament then. So, like, a month out from the actual thing, they moved it to Argentina, who themselves hadn't actually qualified. They missed out on qualifying through the South American route, and, yeah, lucky lifeline for them. If you host it, then you get to play in it, which you otherwise would not have. And because Indonesia aren't hosting it, they no longer get to go to it. So they were supposed to be the host. They backed out of that, and therefore they didn't actually qualify. So straight swap. The Argentina drew the New Zealand team in their group, as well as Guatemala and Uzbekistan. So a couple potentially winnable games. You can definitely see the Kiwi under-20s with a good opportunity there to make it through to the next round, as they've done in the previous three under-20 World Cups that they've been to. Obviously not the same players, but here is the squad for you. Just breezing through it nice and quickly. Oli Kolodi, Finn Conchi, Kyan Donkers, Oli Fay, Norman Garbutt, Henry Gray, Jay Herdman, Isaac Hughes, Jackson Jarvi, Noah Karuna, right now Albie Kelly-Heald, and Lucas Kelly-Heald, Finn Linder, Jackson Manuel, Dan McKay, Everton O'Leary, Aryan Raj, Kay Sims, Adam Supic, Finn Sermon, and Ben Wallace. So, a couple notes on that. There is no Matt Dibley-Diaz. Was hoping that the Fulham midfielder with the Kiwi heritage, certainly through his mother's side, as I understand it, was hoping that would get done. Had heard some sort of, you know, relatively confident whispers, I think, from Coach Darren Baisley, if I'm remembering this correctly, that he was hopeful that there was a, you know, a chance that that could happen. It didn't, so it's a little bit unfortunate. It would have been nice to see the Fulham prospect get through, and this, I mean, You know what? I was about to say this was his last opportunity to play for a Kiwi youth side, but it's actually not, because he'll still be young enough to potentially partake in the Olympics. Is that next year or the year after? It must be next year, because the Olympics obviously got pushed back a year, so it's only a three-year turnaround, so the under-23s, he could still do that, so it's not impossible. It's obviously easier to get guys in at the youth level than it is at the senior level. So if there's a possibility of Dibley Dare's plan for New Zealand, maybe we kick the can down to that Olympic squad instead. He's not there. Neither are a few other overseas blokes. There are definitely some, you know, quite a few players based in foreign nations within this list. A few of them were part of qualifying and have moved overseas since. A few others weren't part of qualifying because they were already overseas. But not as many as I thought there might be. Like, they tried out a couple Aussie-based guys they played a little quad series in Indonesia a couple months ago. They tried out a couple Aussie-based guys there who none of them made it here. They tried out Oscar Obel Hall in that one as well. Christchurch striker who's been playing for, I think, Esbjerg in Denmark. We're a top division Danish side. He plays for their under-19s, so it's not quite the... you know, it's not first team duties, but he's been there for a couple of years, and I was a little bit surprised not to see him in this group as well. 16 of the 21 players here were in the squad that qualified through the Oceania tournament, so heaps of continuity there. Most of these guys all played together. A lot of them had anyway, because there's, as you would expect, quite a big Wellington Phoenix contingent. 8 of the 21 players are current Wellington Phoenix players. 11 of them also have priors, because you've got Henry Gray, who left a year or two ago and is listed here as on trial in England. He has also, I know he spent some time, I think, trialing with, I think it might have been Central Coast Mariners, something like that, and played a bit for Waterside Karori last year, if I'm remembering that right. Who else have we got that's left there? Jackson Manuel's left the Knicks and gone to play for Western Springs in the Northern League, as has Adam Supic, who's at Eastern Suburbs. So there you go, bit of a Wellington Phoenix, the pipelines spreading the wings. What else? Let's list. I'll give you five players to watch, five kind of standouts from this squad. First one, let's go Norman Garbutt, who is the younger brother of Matthew Garbutt and who is playing in Italy at the moment at a club called Potenza. They are in the third tier, so Serie C, however you say C in Italian, third tier in Italy, which is the same level that Nicko Kerwin plays at. However, Garbutt is obviously not in their, he's not in their first team, he's in their Primavera team, which is under-19s, but he plays regularly for them, and he scores and assists goals as well. He gets in the numbers there, he puts up figures just like his older brother does. Definitely a fella who is full of potential, excited to see what he can do, largely because I haven't actually really seen him play at all before. He wasn't in either of the other under-20 squads, so this is a good opportunity for that bloke. Number two, I think, is probably a split. I'm just going to share them. Ollie Collotti and Kyan Donkers. Collotti still says on trial in England. I know he'd bounced around a couple of clubs, and he got injured at one of them. Trying to remember where. Sheffield Wednesday, I'm sure, was one of the teams that he spent some time at, and one or two others. He apparently is still on trial in England. I can't remember seeing his name in any Northern League or, National League, Prelim, Regional League squads. So I think that's, there you go. I guess that's the answer to that, is because he's still over in England on trial, whereas Kyan Donkers is playing for NEC Nijmegen, I think. So, yeah, he is. There we go on the list. These two, the reason I highlight them is because they're the two strikers in the team. If there is I think it is a valid criticism of the Wellington Phoenix Academy, is that pretty much since Ben Wayne, they haven't, they've had a bit of a dearth of strikers, like goal scorers, like finishers. They've had some good creative players, really good midfielders, great defenders, just haven't quite had the guys to put the ball in the back of the net, which is where Collotti and Donkers came in very handy in qualifying, because in a team that was dominated by Wellington Phoenix players, you could insert these two, both based out of the Canterbury region. or both hailing from the Canterbury region. Ollie Colotti, I know, spent some time with Christchurch United but didn't make their first team last year and was offered Melville United instead, so he moved up to the Waikato and scored a bunch of goals. Kai and Donkers was playing for Kashmir Tech. They've obviously both left overseas to try their luck elsewhere since then, taking the necessary steps. Those two are the top scorers, equal golden boot in qualifying. Expect them to be very dominant again in terms of this team's goal output at the tournament, at the under-20s. Next up, Jay Herdman was the golden ball winner in qualifying. Son of John Herdman, who roundly rejected the All-Whites request to have him... Well, it wasn't even a request. I mean, the bro went through... He had to have applied to get as far as he did, so he obviously was trying his luck, but ultimately recommitted to Canada, although the NZ football fellas have been saying recently that nobody's out of the running from their original shortlist, which is crazy stuff, but whatever. Jay Herbin, real good though. He counts himself as a Kiwi. He's based in Canada, where he plays for the Vancouver Whitecaps youth team and seems to be a fairly prominent player for them, particularly this season. I think he seems lined up to be, I don't know, a little bit of a breakthrough for him. So definitely a dude with big potential. He played for the under-23s as well recently. Very good attacking midfielder. See how he goes. Case Sims wasn't part of the previous under-20s squads because he's been over in Sweden doing his goalkeeping things. He did spend a very interesting off-season where he went on trial at a few different places, less so because it was like a imminent transfer, more in the line of like, let's get some experiences working with some good coaches, maybe work on some, I don't know, never hurts to build some networking lines as well. So he went to, I think, one of the biggest clubs in Norway. I can't remember which off the top of my head. But he then also went to England, where he spent some time at Leicester City, most notably. But also, I believe he dropped by Nottingham Forest right around the time that Chris Wood had just signed for them as well. So, and I think it might have been Coventry in the division below. So he, you know, went through a few different clubs. He's definitely a goalkeeper with big potential. Hasn't played at age grade before. He's a Western Suburbs Ole Academy guy. But he did play for the under-23s against China in one of those games. He played in the second game, whereas in the first game he did the thing where he sat on the bench for the All-Whites first team. So great experiences from that bloke. I expect him to be the number one goalkeeper, and he's a dude with massive potential. Loved watching him in the National League a couple years ago. Not just the saves, but he's also really good with his feet and his distribution. His passing range is exquisite for a goalkeeper, so love some of that. And let's just chuck in some Finn Sermon on the end of that, because Sermon, you know, hasn't really got the same opportunities this season for the Wellington Phoenix first team. He's actually been out of the squad quite a lot recently, since the Central League started, and playing for that team instead, playing for the reserves, as you need to do, keep your minutes up. It's been tricky for Sermon because I think last year he got thrown in probably a little early, but had a nice run of games because of injuries elsewhere, and they showed some real solid growth, because I'd felt from watching him in the Central League team that he was often a guy who... he looked like he had all the tools to be a superb defender, and he was a couple years younger. Like, he was slightly ahead of his wave as well, playing in that team when he first got into there anyway. But he was also a guy who, like, I think I remember him getting sent off a couple times and scoring an own goal or two. Like, he was a guy who would have a big mistake in him, which is not unusual for a young defender. Like, nothing to worry about, but it's definitely something of, like, the kind of thing that gets ironed out with more experience. So it was a little bit of not a concern, but it was just the risk of pushing him into the A-League team as quickly as he did. But that just shows how quickly he has been growing and how, you know, how fast he's developing as a player. He's a really good central defender who, unfortunately, I mean, there's just been a better rate of fitness in the Wellington Phoenix first team this season. So the opportunities haven't come around the same way they did at the end of last season. But he's keeping busy, and he's, I would suggest, probably a good chance to captain this team when they go to the Under-20 World Cup. So he's definitely going to get his spotlight there, as are all of these fellas within that squad. Let's do some question time. I have to ask myself the question here, but I'm going to ask myself, what's the most notable thing from your Flying Kiwis yarn this week? And the most notable thing from the Flying Kiwis yarn this week is that Rhea Percival has returned from her ACL injury, the one that she suffered in April last year against Australia playing for the Football Ferns. Turns out it wasn't just an ACL tear, it was also a meniscus tear. It was the double banger, and the according to one of her Instagram posts about the recovery, she said the doctor told her that it was one of the worst that he's ever seen, and that there was a, you know, genuine risk she might not be able to play football ever again, which, honestly, I swear every athlete who's out for a long term has that story. Like, the, I don't know if there's doctors covering their asses or whatever. It just seems like everyone at some point gets told, like, well, there's a chance you might never play again, which I guess is the case for anyone at any point, at any time, in any activity, but whatever. Percival, no doubts that she was going to just, you know, give it the full effort for the full length of time, whatever it took, or the not going to cut any of them steps, and she didn't, and has been steadily, like, that's been a really encouraging thing over the last couple months, is you just get these steady little, I don't know, milestones, like a clip from the Spurs social media accounts being like, well, here she is in the first game, like first time she's back on running on grass, and here she is working in the gym, and here she is, you know, kicking a ball around a little bit, and now she's back in training. And then last week the word was that she is expected to be a part of the WSL squad to face Brighton, and she was named on the bench, and with about 8 minutes to go she was subbed on, making her return official from injury about what, 13 months later. So just in time to get a nice little run of games at a very high level, just, you know, leading into the World Cup, get some of that match fitness back, and at a time where, you know, Percival is probably a real key player for the Football Ferns in a number of ways. One, she plays at a high level. Two, she is quite important to how they want to operate, because you've got a midfielder with a high work rate who wins the ball back and also can distribute it nice. That's not her strength of her game, but she does a job, certainly. But in particular, it's that pressing, and it's that energy and the work rate and being able to win the ball back. And they've missed her significantly since she's been injured. It's been a major factor. Percival is maybe the Ferns' best player. If she's not the best, she's in the top three most important. And you've looked at some of their terrible results recently, it's not hard to see, well, Vic Hessen didn't play in a lot of those either, and she's also probably a top three in terms of certainly in terms of influence and leadership these days, even though she is relatively less experienced, having only really in the last couple years broken in as a regular. If you go in top three, you'd probably go Liv Chance for the other one, because she's the most important attacker. CJ Bott would be relatively high on the list as well, and she's missed some time too. And you just, we don't have that much depth. The more that key players miss games time, like, the worst results are going to be. I think, unfortunately, the solo mission means we've been robbed today of an opportunity to hear Scotty's takes on the Warriors game on the weekend, which would have been quite an enthralling listen, as always, but you know, there's already an article up, you can get in amongst that. But I think certainly from my more amateur, ignorant perspective on the Warriors, it did feel like one of those things, not just this week, but also in the Storm loss as well, where they had a few injuries mid-game, which is even worse. It just, like, one of those things where it's like, every time you take a starting level player out of the team, you're going to get a little bit worse. And that doesn't mean you're going to lose. That just means the margin for error gets smaller. Football Ferns have just had too many of those. But Rhea Percival is back now, and nothing could have been more significant than that over the week of Flying Kiwis action. Although, tune in for that article, as always, because you got goals this week. There's some bangers that were scored. There's some real influential performances. It's one of them weeks which was just, like, real fun to put together, because, you know, I haven't found myself having to scrape through and, like, how do we fill this out? How do we get to, like, 13, 14, 15 entries on this thing without just chucking in a paragraph? So-and-so lost and played 20 minutes off the bench and nothing really happened. Sometimes you got to go through those. These days, less so. Like, in the last year or so, definitely, it's a lot more of, like, who do I leave out rather than who do I include? But, you know, it's chock full this week. It's a beauty of an article. that's the end of question time. Where do I want to go from here? Do I do some musical jams? There was a Thundercat and Tame Impala song. That was pretty cool. I've got this bloody... The band Spark, so I didn't know anything about until Edgar Wright did a documentary about them like a year or two ago. And I never watched the documentary, so I still don't know much about them. But I've at least like become aware of their existence. They had a song called Veronica Lake, named after the 1940s film star. Got some movie recommendations there. There's Sullivan's Travel. She's in that. That's real good. And I Married a Witch is also more of a lighthearted, screwball-y affair, but that's also quite a fun movie. I do like my old films, but I can't remember anything else she's in that I've seen. I do know she's one of those actresses who had a little bit of a tragic life and an early burnout, and the old boozing probably didn't help. But Sparks have got a song called Veronica Lake, which I heard the first time, chucked it in the weekly playlist like 2 weeks ago, and it was fine. Then I heard it again, and it stayed in my head, and it's still in my head, and it's just one of them earworm songs. So I've gone back to that one a couple times. It is also the start of a new month, so we'll get the album jukebox out for you in a day or two, probably. Trying to think, what have I written about there? Vera Allen's album will be on there. William Tyler and The Impossible Truth, that will be up there. I think I'll try get another listen through that Soft Plastics one. Band Wednesday had a very good album. Rose City Band, one of my favourites. There's a fair few there. There'll be another Barnstorming 27 FM album jukebox, monthly album jukebox, whatever we call them things. Another one of those, as always. Other than that, I don't know, I guess it's time for me to do the honours of the old Kia Kaha, Stay Beautiful, Chir Chir.